Let us get into the topic of self-love. In between, I'll be sharing my stories. In between, I'll be sharing my childhood stories, which will be very impactful and which many might have gone through the same kind of experiences or different kind of experiences which had put us not to love ourselves. So I'll be sharing in the coming time. And what is self-love? Self-love means caring about oneself, being confident and taking responsibility for oneself with all of our imperfections and flaws. Friends, we always speak about love, 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 unconditional love, unconditional love to others, unconditional love to self. What is that unconditional love means? Unconditional love means accepting yourself as you are, with all the flaws, with all the imperfections, the way you look, the way you think. It's okay. You are with that, so you cannot change it. And if you wish, it's again your choice, friends. If you wish, you can change it. So what you have to do is, however you are, you have to accept yourself. That is what is self-love. That is what is unconditional love. And when I speak about unconditional love, when I speak about love in general, when we accept ourselves with all the imperfections and all the flaws, we start to love others as well. Isn't it? How can we speak about love without experiencing it? How can we expect that we are giving love to others without we being experiencing it, right? So self-love means to be respecting yourself, knowing who you are. Friends, it happened to me in the year of 2009, 2010. I was very deep in depression. I was stuck in depression. I was so lost within myself. Because I got married in the year of 8, and then I was not into meditation at that time. I was a regular girl thinking about the materialistic things, and I used to think only materialistic things brings happiness, or if my husband is there with me, I'm happy, or if my family is there with me, I'm happy. If I have this kind of a bag, I'm happy. So these kind of things were running in my head before practicing meditation. Then what happened in the year of 2008 till 2009, we were shifted to Egypt. And when we shifted to Egypt, I was all alone. My family is in India and I have no friends. So I was thinking, I have to be busy. I have to be really busy. And what is the thing which I can be busy with? Only if I become a mother, I'll be busy. See, friends, I'm not blaming myself again. Maybe it was the time that I have to go through that phase and to come to meditation. So I don't blame myself, but see the thoughts how I was having at that time. Just because I have to get busy, I wanted to become a mother. Though I was not ready. I was 22 years old and I'm not matured enough to take the decisions about myself and to take the decisions about the kid who is coming to the world. And then I started praying to God, oh God, please, I have to get pregnant and all these things. You know, like within a month or two, I became pregnant. When I became pregnant, I started feeling happy. Oh my God, I've achieved so much. I feel joy. I started feeling, that I have everything in the world. And then after two and a half, 3 months, I had a miscarriage. So when I had a miscarriage, I went into a depression, very bad depression. All the negative thoughts about myself, all the past, the guilt, everything started coming up. Everything started coming up. And I was not knowing how to come out of that depression. I used to lock myself in my room and I used to not come out. I used to not speak to anybody. I started gaining weight. I started eating more and every sort of thing I did. And then I started hating myself, friends. Look, I started hating myself with that incident because I was not aware. I was not aware that it is okay. It is okay to have a miscarriage. It's okay. We all have challenges in our lives. We all have troubles in our lives. But it's when it is what do you say, that when it is given right from the childhood that we have to love ourselves for everything, whatever is happening, it's okay. If we have given that thing, then I think no kid will suffer when the kid becomes an adult. My mom, she did all good things, but knowingly or unknowingly, they are lost in their world. Isn't it, friends? They are lost in their world. And then now we cannot blame them as well. And then when this miscarriage happened to me, I was in depression. I started hating myself. And I was not responsible about myself. And then after coming into meditation, in 2010, I'm so glad that my in-laws came to Egypt and they said, you meditate and everything will be fine. I was not believing in them. I was saying that, how can a meditation can pull me out of my depression? So how can it pull me? So I was thinking like that. But they've been telling me, insisting me. So I thought, why not giving it a try? So I gave a try. Today I'm giving you already the key, one of the keys to accept yourself, to love yourself. And that time when they told me that to meditate, I said, okay, I'll take this challenge for a week. And in 1 week, if I feel better, I'll continue doing it. I'll continue sharing it. If I don't feel anything better, it stays an experience, I said to myself. Friends, I'm telling you, in that 1 week, the first day when I sat in meditation, there were millions of thoughts. There were so many thoughts I could not explain. But I was so strict with myself that I have to sit in meditation no matter what. I will not give power to my thoughts. So I used to sit for 6 hours a day, and sometimes I used to sit for the whole night and meditate. Within a week's time, I found this inner joy. I started feeling happy for no reason. I started accepting myself as I am. I started seeing the clear picture for why this miscarriage had happened to me. Only when you know yourself, only when you have love for yourself, you will have the clarity, friends. If you don't know yourself and if you don't love yourself, you will never have a clarity, because there is only confusion. There is only confusion. You're just creating a facade that you are loving yourself or you're loving others. It's just a facade, friends. So let us today, let us make an attempt to take out all these curtains that we have covered up so that the light can shine through. Yeah. So, and many people have question about, is self-love selfish? Many people have this question. Self-love is not being selfish, friends. Self-love is not being selfish. And it's a myth that we have fed into ourselves, created for ourselves. Or I can say that it's again a belief system. If I take care of others first, then I'm okay. If I take care of myself, I'm selfish. We have always these thoughts. We always think like that. So no, friends, being in self-love doesn't mean you're selfish, and you should always take care of yourself. See, a woman or a mother's in the home, what they do? They do so much of housework, they do so much of cooking, and they don't eat. Though they are hungry, they don't eat. They feed their husband, they feed their children, and afterwards they eat. They are hurting themselves. If they are hungry, they should eat. They have to respect their own self. They have to respect their own bodies. They have to respect their own soul. The soul is really, feeling hurt. Or the self is really feeling hurt. Your body is feeling hurt. But the mother doesn't think about that. The mother thinks, no, I'm really doing great things. It happened to me, friends. It happened to me also. I was doing the same when I was in Egypt. I love to see people eating. I love to feed people. And what happened, there were masters from India, like Patriji was there as well. And there were so many masters who came, and we were around 20 people or something like that in our home. And Patriji, we started cooking, and the food was kept on the table, and everybody started eating, and and everybody finished. And afterwards, Patriji asked me, did you eat? I said, no, Patriji, I did not eat. You know, then what he said, you know, like he said, do you think that you are a great person? You think that you are doing good to yourself? How are you doing good to yourself? Being hungry, you're not eating and you're feeding us. You should never do that, he said, friends. From that time, if I'm hungry, I'm telling to all the mothers in the home, I'm telling to all the women in the home, if you're hungry, just take a bite, but don't starve yourself. Don't trouble yourself thinking that you have to first feed your husband or you have to first feed your children. If you can take care of yourself first, then you can take care of your family. Yeah, so that message which Patriji had given me was the simple ones that, you know, like we always have this misconception that if I take care of others, then I'm good. It's not like that, friends. First, you have to take care of yourself. So, and again, self-love is not selfish. Even if you eat, nobody will think that you're selfish, right? You take a bite. I'm not telling you to eat everything and, you know, finish it off. No, you just take a bite, satisfy your hunger. And then afterwards you sit with your family and you eat again. No problem. But when you are doing so many things in the home and if you feel hungry, please eat it. Please note it, friends. Please note it. And if you think of others, who will think of you? See? You are taking care of your family, you're taking care of your friends, you're taking care of the house, you're taking care of everything. Then who will think of you? And I'm also telling about the men. I'm not only pointing, self-love is not only for women, it is also for men. What, right from the childhood, men have been fed like, men has to take care about the family, men has to bring the money to the home. All these things men had put into their head, or the families or the society had put into their heads that the man has to behave like this or that. If a man love himself, it's like, oh, he's so, you know, like delicate or, you know, something like that, they tag to that person. No, friends, you have to love yourself. You have to love yourself. And the work you are doing, how can you say that you are doing so much work outside? How can you say that the job which you are doing, how can you bring balance if you don't love yourself? There is so much of, you are doing so much giving to your work, but are you taking care of yourself? In 24 hours, 12 hours or 13 hours you are spending at your work. You come back home. And when you come back home, you are really tired. Is there a time to think about yourself? Is there a time where you can say that I'm taking care of myself? Are you really thinking of yourself? Are you taking a walk? Are you really doing what you are passionate about apart from your work? And then you sleep, you eat, you sleep. And then the next day it's the same, friends. Give it a thought. Because life is really, really beautiful. We are not just born like that. Everybody is born for a reason. We just came with so much planning, so much planning. What happens is when we came here, we forgot about everything what we have planned above. We have chosen our parents, we have chosen our circumstances, we have chosen everything, even our job. But it is our choice to be happy. It is our choice to be stress-free. It is our choice to love ourselves. Are we choosing the real thing? Are we choosing the real happiness? Think about it, friends. Because it is always good to think. It's always good to think, what am I doing in my life? Am I really doing good? Am I really doing good to myself? Just give it a thought. And we always think about others, what others think. All these things. So come out of this thought that what others will think, what I will do. No, stop all these things and just do whatever you feel like doing. Do whatever you're passionate about. Do whatever you feel like doing it. But don't stop yourself in loving yourself. Don't say that, no, I cannot love myself. don't stick in that pattern fence. Yeah. So when you are in that pattern, you are just creating just a facade. You're just layering it up, but you're not true to yourself. Yeah. And this is one of the beautiful things which I've read recently in a book of Paramahamsa Yogananda. He says the importance of getting along with yourself. So to be able to get along with yourself is very marvelous, friends, isn't it? To be able to get along with ourselves is very marvelous. Most people find it difficult to get along with others. Suppose I have a very strict boss, or if I have a very rude friend, it is very difficult to get along with that person. But have you ever given a thought in getting along with yourself? If you do not love yourself, how can you expect that you love others? If you cannot get along with yourself, how can you think that you can get along with others? That's why self-love and acceptance is very important. Accepting as you are. You cannot get away from yourself. Even if you travel to the other space, you cannot get away from yourself. Right in this moment, you have given a choice to love yourself, to do whatever you wish to do. It is all your choice, friends. It is really your choice. So choose wisely. Instead of fighting with yourself, why not getting along with yourself? It is so easy to get along with yourself. The moment you have a thought, the moment you have any negative thought about yourself, just cut the thought. Anapanasati meditation is so simple and it is so good. Even just for a minute, even just for a second, if you focus on your breath, that thought just disappears, because that thought is not interested in you. The more you think about that thought, the more it's like a chain. It goes forward. So please get along with yourself. When you get along with yourself, you can get along with any kind of person in the whole world. And now getting back to this topic of deep-rooted issues. So friends, this is very important. Are there any deep-rooted issues that's stopping you to love yourself? Like anger, guilt, or jealousy? So I'll tell you an example. I was having these kind of emotions. I was deep-rooted issues, I think, right from my childhood. So I was born in the year of 1986. After I was born, 1.5 year after I'm born, my sister is born. So what happened is, like, in that 1.5 year, we think that we are babies, but we can feel things. We can feel things. At that time, I was just, I was so happy in my world that my parents are really taking care of me a lot. And then my sister is born. When she is born, they started taking care of her. When they started taking care of her, I started developing this jealousy or kind of a possessiveness which is inside me. That who is this girl? Where did she come from? I was not knowing all that she's my sister and all these things. Where did she come from? Why is she getting so much importance? That time we don't have this understanding that, you know, like that little one, she's young, so she needs to be in care. So I was not knowing that at that time, but it was a deep-rooted issue. At that time I developed. And after we started growing together, there is still a separation. I used to separate myself from my sister and my brother. They both are close with each other, but I am always separated. I don't know why. I used to think maybe that was the reason, the jealousy which I had developed when my sister is born and a few months after she is born. So that kind of thing, it stayed in my heart. And the jealousy and the possessiveness, they, my sister and my brother, they got along very well, because I think they did not had any kind of issues. But being a firstborn, I had an issue. So I used to cry. I used to say to my, at that time, I used to say to my, oh, wish I could die. You know, like, why am I here on this earth? See, that much of pressure we kids go through. So that was a deep-rooted issue. And that that issue had made me in every walk of my life to have this jealousy feeling. If I have a good friend, she should be there with me only. She should not talk to anybody else. So this kind of attitude I had developed. And about the anger, about this, when you have a jealousy, when you have possessiveness, anger is like, it comes along. It comes along with these things. And the guilt, friends. The guilt, I was in so much guilt because I was not good at studies. I was never good at studies. I did not want to go to school. And what happened is, like, when I was so small, my family used to compare me with my cousins because they used to read very well. And I'm not for studies. I did not do any good studies. So I used to feel bad about myself. Why am I not studying? Why is it not that the studies are not getting into my head? I started going into the guilt mode. I went into the guilt mode. Oh, I'm not doing good to my parents. I'm not good. I'm not doing good to my my family. I'm not bringing good name to my family. These thoughts came into me. See, friends, I'm openly sharing this to you. Many people, they don't share that they have these kind of deep-rooted issues. So we have to work on our deep-rooted issues. How do we work on our deep-rooted issues? Only when we see that we have that issues. Only we see that the repetitive patterns which we have in our day-to-day life that we are going through. So then when we have these repetitive patterns, then automatically we can say that, oh, this is the issue I'm going through. So now I will work on this issue because this issue is blocking me to love myself. So you that is where you have to work, friends. We all have deep-rooted issues. It's not like there is no exception. See, because of these kind of issues, we have to be grateful that these kind of incidents happen in our life so that we can come out of these incidents. So the more we carry these deep-rooted issues, the more we carry, the roots become very strong. So it is never too late, friends. It is never too late. What you have to do is, if you witness any deep-rooted issues like anger, unnecessary anger. I'm not saying the anger just the right anger. There is a right anger. There is an unnecessary anger. The right anger is like in a situation where the thing should be straight. There you should be a little angry only for that moment. But after you finish, the situation is finished. You should not carry that anger. That is the right anger. The unnecessary anger is for silly reasons you get angry. So if you are facing that thing, so just close your eyes and look into yourself. What is that thing which is bothering you? What is that thing which is causing you this this anger emotion in you? You have to see to yourself. When you really see, close your eyes, Patriji says, physical eyes, when you close your physical eyes, then you see through the mind's eye. When you close the mind's eye, you connect to your soul's eye. So you have to connect to your soul's eye and you have to see that what is that issue which is making you to be like this. Because we think what this is us, but this is not us. Friends, this anger is not you. This guilt is not you. This jealousy is not you. But you're carrying it. Right? So what you have to do is you have to plug the roots. You have to take the roots. It takes time. It really takes time because that's why if you have kids or if you're planning for kids, please start having these conscious thoughts. Please start giving them the right values right from their childhood that they have to, whenever they are going through some emotions, sit with them, work with them, and then so that it can be removed easily. Because the roots will be not that strong. But whereas when we become adults, it is very difficult. I can understand. But what you have to do is you have to be really patient and you have to sit there every day and you have to pull those issues out. In that way, the roots comes out. Right, friends? It is very, very important to work with the deep-rooted issues because if you do not work with the deep-rooted issues, it will stay there and it will carry forward. It will carry forward for your next lives as well. So So why not, if because this life is so beautiful, this life is a great opportunity for us. In this life, why not clearing it? Why not seeing it and taking it out? Yeah. And the next thing is challenges. We have so many challenges in our lives. The challenges like someone else will provide a solution. So why do you put yourself in a back seat that somebody else will provide a solution for you? Why can't you decide for yourself? Again, this is a deep rooted issue, because we might have heard somewhere in our childhood, in our past, that we have blocked ourselves. We had low self esteem. We have said, no, I cannot do it. Maybe one time you might have done something which is not right, which did not give you progress. So you sat in the back seat and you gave your steering to somebody else. So now, starting from today, take a decision for yourself. Take a decision, give a solution. So don't wait for others to give a solution to you. So someone else will have the answer for all the questions I have. Someone else will have the answer. Friends, you have all the answers within. For all the questions you have all the answers within. What you have to just do is just go within. This key which I have told you earlier in meditation. When using this key, you can have all the answers. You can overcome all the challenges. You can gain the strength. You can be independent. So again, this problem is someone else will do it better than I do. So this is again a problem, friends. This is again we have to work. Someone else will do it better than I can do. It's you always putting others as a priority. You are putting others like others will do good, but I cannot do good. How can you think about yourself like that? You can do great. Only if you think, only if you choose to do that thing. Choose wisely, friends. Again, it's again thought patterns. Each time you have a thought, negative thought about yourself, pluck it out. Take that roots and throw it away. Because it is, and be grateful for that thought. Don't curse that thought that it came to you. So it is the more these thoughts, the more these kind of challenges comes, that's where we can prove ourselves. Now that's where we become strong. If these kind of challenges won't come, we cannot prove ourselves. So don't always think that someone else will do better than I do. Someone else will cook better than I can. So don't think like that. Someone else will do great art. I was thinking like that, friends, when I was in my college. What happened is, like, I love arts. I had an argument with my father that my father wanted me to be an engineer. I said to my dad that it is very hard for me to study. I had a failure. I failed in my plus two, and I sat 1 year at home. And I'm really grateful for that 1 year that I sat, so that I could introspect myself. I said, I did not want to do that studies. I want to do something else. And thanks to my aunt, who said that, okay, there is a studies called Bachelor of Fine Arts. So you write an exam and you see whether you can pass through it. So I thought, okay, I'll go ahead. My father said, see, if you go there, you will not study. I mean, like, you will not do the arts, because I want you to become an engineer, or you have to do some degree. Because back in 2004, Bachelor of Fine Arts was not that famous. So people used to, I think it's a mentality of all the parents, because all the parents want their kids to have this good education, good job, good living, and all these things. So my father was also thinking about me like that. So he was not knowing what art can bring, because my father had brought up like that. So very straight thinking, you know, like, you have to study this and you have to earn this, like that. So, but I did not want to study. And I got into Bachelor of Fine Arts. And when I got into Bachelor of Fine Arts in Hyderabad, JNTU, so all my friends in the class were doing really great. You know, they were doing great paintings. I was not that good again there. And I started feeling low self-esteem. I'm not doing good. Again, I'm a failure here as well. So I was okay, but not good like them. The comparison, you see, I started comparing myself to others. So when you start comparing yourself to others, you see only suffering. Right from my childhood, I've been compared to my cousins because my cousins used to study good. So that's what is in my head. Each time I see somebody better than me, I used to compare myself. Oh, I wish I could do something like them. Or, you know, like they do better than I. So the same challenge which is mentioned here, I was also going through that. But friends, after I practiced meditation, I came out of this feeling that, you know, like I'm better than somebody or I'm less than somebody. No, we are all great in our own things. We all have to accept ourselves and also others as well. So when you accept yourself, when you accept others, there is no comparisons. There is no challenges at all. And afterwards, when I started practicing meditation, I started seeing visions. I started seeing colors because art is my passion. And through that, I started seeing this sacred geometry in my meditations, and I started putting it out. And then, friends, I started loving myself because art is an expression. Afterwards, I'll be showing you one of my artworks. And you will see how it had been transformed. How low self-esteem girl when in college had been, and now transformed myself into a self-loving girl, low self-esteem girl to a self-loving girl. So you see it, when you love yourself, you will love whatever you're doing. So I started doing whatever I'm doing, I started loving myself. If I'm cooking, I'm cooking so happily. If I'm painting, I'm painting so happily. So there is no feeling that somebody else will do better than I can do. Yes, there are so many people that are doing great things, great art. I really appreciate them. We should always have this quality of appreciation. Then there is no feeling of jealousy. Because when you compare yourself to others, then there is jealousy. If you don't compare yourself to others, if you accept yourself, if you are content with yourself, then there is no jealousy at all. So someone else will do it better than I can do. I was also thinking the same thing, but now I came out of it. And the big one, friends, I am not good enough. This is the big, big, big challenge that we all go through. I'm not good enough. I'm not looking good. I was also the same, friends. I was looking at myself because I'm getting personal here, but I would like to share my big arms. And I used to feel bad. Why I should get all these things? Why I'm like this? I started hating myself. Because of my physical body, I started hating myself. Why is my body like that? You know, like, why am I not like others? You know, they are so beautiful. They are so slim and they are so nice. And why are my arms are like this? I started cursing myself. I did not accept myself. And also one more thing, I was not good smiling. I was not smiling good at all. I was like, you know, like very fake smile I used to give. I really, because that time I was not accepting myself completely. But when I accepted completely, then I started having this real laugh, this smile coming from my heart. So it's not faking. It's just coming out naturally. Then I could able to see the difference. The before the previous smiles, photographs show how comfortable you are. So in the photographs, I used to see myself, oh my God, a few years back, look at me, how I'm smiling. And my smile is so fake because so much of things were running in my head. So much of load is there in my head and heart. So how can I smile happily? It's impossible. But once I unloaded everything, once I cleared everything, once I started loving myself, I started seeing the pictures, the after pictures, and I see, wow, what a beauty. I started loving myself. You see how beautiful I am. It's not a beauty from the pride. It's a beauty from the real joy, from the heart. Oh my God, look, you're like a child. You're smiling like a child. So this kind of a quality I've developed. And always you don't say to yourself that you are not good enough. We are all good in all the ways. The way you look, you're good. Even if you're dark, if you're short, if you're not good at studies, you're good. You're good. You're doing, maybe that's why you are designed your life. I've designed my life that I have to have this arms like this. So I accepted it. But when you don't accept and when you start to compare to others that, oh, others are so fair, oh, others are so slim, then there is only suffering. So stop doing it, friends, and start appreciating yourself as you are. And you see the beauty. When you start to appreciate yourself, you really see the beauty in yourself. And this, I have seen it. And the fears. So one of the ways to self-love is to move out of fear. We all have fears. Fear stops us, friends. If someone wants to share, please do share if you are having any kind of fears. So it's let us keep it interactive. Yes, Shalini, can you hear me properly?
Yes.
So friends, if anybody have any kind of fears, I had a fear of failure. I had a fear of I'm not good enough. So if anybody is having fear of anything, fear of parenting properly. Yes. Yes. Losing a fear of family member's death. Fear of heights and blood. Wow. So see, we all have so many fears. What we can do here? How we can work with our fears? Fear of public speaking. Oh my, that's my favorite thing, friends. That's my favorite thing. I was having a fear of public speaking. I was so scared. You know, I was brought up in a family. I was brought up, my father was very strict. My father was, maybe I don't say it strict. My father wants us to be secured. He doesn't want us to expose to the outer world. So he wants to keep us intact, you know. And I was in schools or in college, I never performed. I never spoke on stage. I was having a very bad stage fear. And in 2010, I remember, and when we started meditating, inviting people to the home to meditation, just few people, it's okay to speak to them. But once I went back to India in 2010, May 5th, that was the first time I had an opportunity to speak in front of 3,000 or 3,500 people. That was in a marriage. It happened in my hometown. And Patriji was there. And Patriji got to know that we were in Egypt. And Patriji wanted us to speak about what we were doing in Egypt, how the classes are going on in Egypt. So he called us onto the stage and he asked me to speak. And I have no words. I became so silent. I have no words. My goodness. What I will speak in front of these many people, I was not expecting that. But then afterwards, he said, there is nothing to fear. Just go ahead. When he said that, the words came out just naturally. So from then, the fear of public speaking had dropped, friends, because what happens is when you start to meditate, once you start to be with yourself, once you connect with yourself, all these fears drop. Then you realize that everybody is you. And when everybody is you, what is a fear? That fear dropped. So thank you. Thank you for writing it and reminding it of this fear, particularly fear of public speaking. Yes, it is very important, friends. And once we meditate, once we have these keys to self-love, we will come out of these all kinds of fears. fear of losing money, the insecurity fears and feeling rejected. Oh, I had went through these kind of rejections, you know, like before somebody rejects, I reject them. Because I was having that, because I had so many rejections in my school or in my college or everywhere, you know, like my family, some relatives, you know, like they used to reject me because I'm not good at studies, you know, like they used to tag only good studying people we really love. So these kind of thoughts they had, and I started feeling about myself the same way. So before they reject, what happened after I became big, I started rejecting because of the fear of rejection. Oh my God, what happens if they reject me? So before they reject me, let me reject them. So I, even the friends as well. So if there is any kind of differences that I'm going through with my friends, before they say, okay, Katif. So I used to Katif from them, and then I used to be on my way. So yes, friends, that fear of rejection we all have. So feeling rejected at work, feeling rejected at family, feeling rejected of at outside. So yes, that's one of the fears, fear of people with who shout. Yes, yes, yes. And fear of public speaking again, fear if I will not remain in good books. Again, see, this is again one of the important fears, friends, that we all have, that we always want to look good in front of others, right? We always want to create this scene that we are doing great to others. Or, you know, in that way, what you're doing is you are hurting yourself. You're hurting yourself. Are you really to fall into the good books of others? Are you really hurting yourself? Put this question to yourself. You don't need to be good to everything. Sometimes you need to say no means no. Sometimes there are things that you have to say no. But we will not say no. Because we have been brought up like that, we should not say no. We have to be humble. We have to say yes to everything. No, we should not say that. How can you say that? You cannot say that. Right from today, start working on yourself. Say that it's okay. It's okay if they think that I'm bad. If they think that, because we are not here being bad or something. We are being right to ourselves. See, in being good books in others' life, you are in your own books. You are not having good to yourself. So create good in your own books. Write good things about yourself in your own books. Yes, today I took care of myself. I stood out for myself and I said no. Because it was much needed for me to say no. And later, if people think whatever they think, it is none of my business. When you think like that, friends, I'm telling you, automatically you will fall into the good books of others. Because you are respecting yourself, you are taking care of yourself, you are standing out for yourself. So don't again fall into the trap that we should always be in the good books of others. No, it's okay to sometimes for the people to think that you are not good, but later they will understand. And fear of talking to office colleagues. So friends, this is again the keys which I had. Meditation. The meditation helped me a lot. Today I'm giving you the one of the most important keys, as thanks to Shalini and Ananti for the 10 minutes of guidance which they did initially. So in every situation you are going through, if you have these kind of fears, if you see these kind of fears are coming out, just close your eyes and observe your breath. And when you observe your breath, you will understand that whatever you're breathing, everybody is breathing the same. When you have this kind of thought that we are all one and the same, the fears drop. Fear of talking to colleagues drop. Fear of failure drops. Everything, the fears drop. So fear of losing someone you love. Yes, fear of, that is one of the fears as well, friends. So And always understand that nothing is permanent. In life, nothing is permanent. Even the fears which you have is not permanent. So let us now today take this opportunity, take this lessons that we will all work with our fears. We will all pull our fears out and we will say bye-bye to our fears. Right from today, we will welcome the self-love to our own self. Fear of losing parents. Yes, friends, fear of losing parents is the most important. I was also feeling the same thing a few years back, but the more you feel you are attached to anything or any person or any situation, you end up in suffering. So, and just whenever I have these fears, I just imagine myself, me being in my past lives. I had so many past lives, right? We all had so many past lives. So in that past lives, we had so many parents, so many siblings, so many situations, but still we got through it. We got through, isn't it? So why we have to have fear of all these things? When you are with your parents, please be with them. Be happy with them. But don't have these fears. And the more you have these kind of fears, the more you will manifest it. So drop these fears because you are giving power to that kind of fears. So please stop doing having these kind of fears. Won't just thinking about self will lead to... No, this is what I said, Gunjan. Yeah, I'm not saying about... self-love. When you have love for yourself, it is not selfish. This is what I'm saying. Because when you are selfish, that's a different thing. You only take care of yourself. Self, yourself, self, self. No. I'm saying when you take care of yourself, when you initially take care of yourself, you will take care of the rest of others, rest of your family or rest of the world. But if you don't take care of yourself, if you're hungry, but still if you want to do good to others, you give them the food. So how are you taking care of yourself? So you're not taking care of yourself. It's like you have to take care of yourself first. That is not selfish at all. And then automatically you will take care of others. So shy of asking help from others. So this is this book which is written by, I don't remember the author name. So ask and it is given. Esther Hicks, I guess. So ask and it is given.
Esther and Jerry Hicks.
Esther Hicks, yes. So ask and it is given. See, if you don't ask, if you keep it to yourself thinking that, oh, other person will read me and they will provide me something. So no, they will not. Only if you ask, then it is given. If you don't ask, nothing is given. So my friend, what if you have any kind of... Ask. Just ask. If they give, take it. If they don't give, also accept that they did not give it. But don't fight. Oh, again, don't fall into the trap that, I asked and they did not give me something. So when you have these kind of things, again, it leads to suffering, friends. So any kind of fear leads to suffering. So let us all from today, let us move out of these fears. It is very important that we have to see that we have these kind of fears. We have to acknowledge that fears and we have to move out of it. So we should not keep holding them. The more you keep holding them, the more you feel heavy. So let's not keep yourself heavy. Let us be light. Let us be in this journey of life. When you imagine yourself loaded with so many bags, just close your eyes and imagine yourself that you have so many bags to carry. And you know, like how you feel that your journey will be so much loaded. You cannot carry because you want to carry so many things, but you cannot carry them. So what I'm telling you today is to remove the bag, to remove the load, whichever is not useful for you. Remove it, throw it away. It's not bringing any good to you. Instead of keeping it to yourself, throw it away. Say, thank you for being in my life for some time. And now it's the time for you to leave. So when you say that peacefully, don't struggle again. peacefully say, communicate with it. Thank you so much for being here and for giving me some lessons. And then just dissolve it. And then that you will feel so much light, and you feel that you just have this backpack. This backpack have only very important things, very good things which are needed. And then you, your journey will be very smooth because you're not loaded, right? So this is, the fears are very important, friends, that we have to work on. And trust. Trust your feelings, emotions, and intuitions. This is very, very, very important, friends. I always keep saying very, very important. I don't know why, but I still, each word and each line is very important here in the topic of self-love, or for that matter, anything where we can learn. So the trust your feelings, emotions, and intuitions. They never lie to you. They will never lie to you. If I have feeling of jealousy, trust that you had this feeling of jealousy. And then immediately say to it, oh, I'm having this jealousy feeling, right? So now it is not bringing any good to me, right? So you remove that. But if you have the jealousy feeling and you don't accept that you are in that feeling, that is not right. Accept that. You don't need to say it out loud to others, but you can say it to yourself. And your emotions. Oh, trust your emotions. Emotions is nothing but energy which is in motion. Intuitions. Again, intuitions are very, very strong, friends. We have to always follow our intuitions. They will never, the first thought which comes to our mind is the intuition. Just follow it. Whether it leads to good or bad, we have to follow it. Trust that thing, and trust your feelings, trust your emotions, and trust your intuitions. It's very important. So it's not what you think you are that holds you back. It is what you think you are is holding you back. See how beautiful is the statement? It is not what you are that holds you back. What you think you are is holding you back. If you think that you are a bad person, that is holding you back. If you think that you are a jealousy person, that is holding you back. If you think that you are a shy person, that is holding you back. Only if you think that you are, that is holding you back. But actually, you are not that. So today, let us all drop these layers. Let us all drop these thought patterns that we had for ourselves. Remove it. Take it off. And regardless of the situations you have in your life, treat yourself well. It is very important, friends. That's the most important thing. See about this picture. In this picture, what's happening? Suppose this is you, and you have to water yourself. You have to feed yourself. You have to take care of yourself. Suppose you bring a plant at home. So every day you need to take care, whether it is having a good sunlight or whether it has enough water. So the same way, you have to take care of yourself as well. You have to water the good thoughts. You have to feed with nice things. Not feed with all the trash. Not feed with all the outside external things and load yourself. So the more you don't take care of yourself, suppose in this pot, in this plant pot, there is no water given, and if there is no compost or manure is given, what happens? The plant will die, isn't it? Why we should die like that? We should live. We should live life to the fullest. And we should always water the beautiful, beautiful thoughts about ourselves. If we don't think, if we don't take care of ourselves, nobody in the world will take care of you. I was thinking initially when I started, when I became a little big, I started thinking myself that, oh, I have to, I have to be good, or, I have to, but I'm just creating a facade, but I'm not really being good to myself. I'm not treating myself well. I'm just not watering the right water. I'm just pouring the dirty water. So let's not do that. Let's treat ourselves completely well, and let's take up the power of our life back. Let's not die. Let's live. And friends, this is one of the exercises I wanted you to do. So first, I want you to do the exercise like the likes and dislikes about others. Others can be your family, your friends, and your boss, anybody. So this is also one of the important exercise, friends, that we have to like do the exercise of likes and dislikes about others. Suppose example, like I have a very tough boss. So what do I like in my boss and what do I don't like in my boss? So let us be little specific, friends. Let us do with one person in our life. That one person, whoever is outside from you is outside. Even it can be your husband, it can be your wife, it can be your friend. So just tell what do you like in that person and what you don't like in that person. Okay, so you like your sister's caring and you don't like your sister's anger. Yes. So friends, now that you have given this likes and dislikes about one person and likes and dislikes about yourself, what did you see? What did you find? Did you find any similarities in that? Question to yourself, did you find any similarities? What is outside you found also inside, right? What you found outside is any person from you, apart from you, is outside. You also found inside the anger. If you don't like your boss being angry at you, bossy at you, you are also bossy at something else. I'm just taking an example. What you have inside is what you see outside. So these are the things where this is a simple exercise which we have to work on a daily basis, friends. So when we work on it a daily basis, so then we drop these judgments about others, to drop this. See, we only see likes. Always see good in others. Drop the negative things about others. So tomorrow I'm going to share a beautiful story which I've heard from my mom when I was a kid. And that's a very touching story. And that will answer all these questions you had, all these dislikes about other person and about yourself also. It will be answered tomorrow. And dislike myself here and bad thoughts. Thank you for writing, friends. That's really, really good to put out, because we have to accept that it's good to say likes about yourself, but it is very hard to say dislikes about yourself. And if you're doing that, that means you're ready. You're ready to see and you're ready to love yourself. Only when we see that we have all these things, when we accept that we have these things, then we can love ourselves. Yeah. So let us all embrace and accept ourselves, friends. It's very, very important. You see how this is your outside self. This is the physical self. And this is your soul. You have to embrace your soul. You have to embrace that one, that little one who is hurt from childhood, from the past. So let us embrace that kid which is inside us. And see, this is the beautiful quote of Buddha. He says, you yourself, as much as anybody in the entire universe, deserve your love and affection. You deserve it. You deserve for your own self. Then why you always think that, oh no, I don't deserve love. I don't deserve these things. You deserve it. You deserve your own love and affection. Give your own love and affection to your own self. Only when we express, that's why Patrija always says, express your whatever you have experienced in meditation, because this is what is Sajjana Sangatya. So whenever we are sharing these things, we understand, oh, it's not only me. There are so many others who are going through. We are also traveling in the same boat. So we will learn from them. So there is so much of learning. So that's why it is important to share it out. And also the reason why, once we share all these things, the dislikes about yourself, the fears about yourself, what happens is you become light, because the heaviness that you've been carrying, it's been robbed. So it is very, very important. If not telling it to me or to any person, but Note it down for yourself. What are your fears? What are your dislikes? Share to your own self and then just take it off. Yes.
Yes, dear friend. So as if you're not expressing, it is all, again, fear of expression.
Yes. Yes. So friends, I would like to show my painting, which I've been working from past 5 years. I'm very patient. I'm very patiently doing. I have no rush. I don't rush things. I really love what I do. I take time, and like any master, like Patriji. See, when he goes to the kitchen, he just cooks so slow, you know, like he puts complete attention to his cooking. He doesn't deviate here and there. So I'm doing this painting from past 5 years. I'm cooking this painting for past 5 years, and I want to show you all, and it's still working. You will not see my face. So
dear friends, this is all mandala.
I hope it is visible.
Yes.
So this is all with a brush, friends. You see how much I hated myself when I was in college, that I'm not doing good. Now when I started loving myself, I started bringing the love which is inside me through the art form. So once we go within, we all bring out that quality in us which is hidden, which we have covered all these years. So that's what I wanted to share. And I also wanted to read a story. So when I'm reading a story, I want you, just a minute, friends. I want you to close your eyes while I'm reading that. It's very important, because to close our eyes while reading. Imagine me as a grandmom. And a grandmom is reading a story to the kids. So just close your eyes. And just introspect yourself, friends. Every time you need to introspect yourself. It's one of the beautiful stories from the book, The Tao of Success. And it says, just give me a moment. The story's name is Temple Renovation. Once upon a time in ancient China, there was an emperor who wished to renovate an ancient temple in the capital city. He issued an imperial decree, and many groups came forward, all hoping to have the honor of working on this project. The emperor's ministers evaluated the groups and eliminated all but two from consideration. Then they reported to him, "Your Majesty, we cannot decide which of the two remaining groups to choose. Each feels it should be the one to renovate the old temple, and each seems to have good reasons." The king says, "Bring them before me. I shall render the final decision." The first was a group of monks. They said, "Your Majesty, no one cares about the temple like we do. Should you decide to grant us this honor, you can be certain that we will do everything possible to restore the temple to its former glory." The second was a group of royal artisans. They said, "Your Majesty, no one has professional expertise like we do. Renovation is what we have done for decades. No other group can do as good as we can. We feel it is only right and proper that we be given the honor." The emperor considered at length and then said, "The ministers were right. It is indeed very difficult to decide. Let me tell you how we shall proceed. South of the palace, there are two small temples that, like the old temple, had also fallen into disuse. I want you to renovate them. At the end of the third working day, I will come for an inspection. My final decision will be based solely on the merits of your work." The ministers took the two groups to the small temples. They assigned one temple to each group and made sure both groups had all the supplies they needed. After 3 days, the emperor came to judge the two groups. Accompanied by the ministers, he walked to the artisan's temple and saw that it was beautiful. All the walls and the roof had been completely repainted. This was done with such a skillful selection of bright colors, which seemed to glow and command attention. Inside, all the furniture had been rebuilt. Everything looked brand new. The emperor praised the artisans. "This is much more than I expected. Now I see what you mean by being the best at what you do. You had made this temple spectacular." The artisans were ecstatic to hear this. They bowed to the emperor to thank him, and then they looked at one another and smiled. With such lavish praise coming from the emperor, their victory was all but guaranteed. Then the emperor and the ministers walked to the other temple, still feeling impressed by the artisans. They all thought it would be impossible for the monks to match such a high level of professional skill. When the monks' temple came into view, they were not prepared for what they saw. The monks did not repaint the temple at all. Instead, they cleaned everything with meticulous attention to detail. The walls showed the colors that had faded over the years, displaying an unexpected beauty beyond description. Free of the dust and dirt that obscured it before, the temple stood revealed in its original glory and ancient character. They walked inside and saw that all the furniture had been carefully polished to a mirror finish. The doors and windows were open, so the colors of the sunset illuminated everything as if they were a part of the temple. They could see the outside. There were trees swaying in the wind and the clouds floating in the sky. Everything seemed to belong together, like a painting coming to life. Rather than to demand their attention, this temple seemed to be perfectly at peace, accepting everything in a state of serenity. The emperor was deeply moved. He turned to the ministers and saw that everyone felt the same way. There was no need to say anything. It was obvious that the emperor had made his final decision. This is a very beautiful story, friends. This is a story where we can introspect ourselves, because there are two temples here, the artisan's temple and the monk's temple. But the monks, what they did is they did not add it too much to it. They did not paint extra load to it. What they did is they just cleared whatever the dust that the temple had accumulated. They have cleared it so that the temple comes back to its glory, comes back to its beauty. So what I'm telling you here is, whatever you have in yourself, don't cover yourself, don't hide yourself. Don't put a nice makeup and don't carry nice bags and go out saying that I'm really happy. Take off all these load. Just clean the dust which is inside you. Clean that hurt which is inside you. And bring that temple which is inside you into this beautiful character. Then that will really shine. You see the real beauty. Not the beauty of the makeup or any other external thing, but the beauty from inside. When it is shined inside, when it is cleaned inside, it is already shown outside. So this is one of the important, beautiful stories, which is from my book. And I like to always read stories.